My name is Sébastien Roy. I'm a faculty at the University of Montreal, and I had the lab doing computer vision. And so I'm going to talk to you about a project called LightTwist, a project interested in doing projection. So it is very closely related to all the graphics interest, because it attempts to project images instead of creating them. So to give a quick overview, the talk is going to be pretty fast, actually. I'm going to be discussing about projectors and the main issue with LightTwist, which is how to project very large, very high resolution images on very large space, large screens, and also screens that are arbitrary shapes and things like that. Basically, some kind of a freedom from the old single projector image. So I'm going to talk about the issues behind projecting on a large scale, and also describe a little bit the LightTwist project itself. This work has been done and touched by many of my students in the past years. So these are a few of them. Now, Vincent Chapdelaine is here at the conference, and he will be showing you what exactly we're talking about. Maybe it's time to mention that instead of showing you slides of what projections can do, we actually brought the screen here. So if you didn't know about it, so we have a room right, I mean, I don't know where the room exactly is. It's an A.
So
yeah.
It's just at the end, if you follow the screens that are out there, the large screens, at the end, on the right, is this room.
Yeah, it's very close by. But anyway, so we brought a screen here, which has a 7 HD projector that projects a big cylindrical image. So that's why I'm going to skip very quickly on the slides that show you the screen, because you can go see it for yourself later. So actually work from people here at the conference and others will be shown in there. So in one word, or I should say maybe a couple of words, what LightTwist is a multi-projector immersion software that does arbitrary projection on arbitrary surfaces, and we'll use a camera to estimate how to distort the projected images so that they look right on the screen. Okay, and so and as a side from this, it has to be able to project not only images but also video and 3D models and whatever, and also synchronize with sound. Okay, so one focus that's really important is that this thing is made for artists, not actually for computer scientists. We made a lot of effort to make it simple to use. Using 7 projectors is never that easy, but we tried our best. The key concept is that you use a single camera that you will put somewhere, and that camera will represent the viewer perspective. And this allows the computer to actually figure out everything. The alignment, also the blending between images, everything. And we try to say that it's high performance, but you'll see why we say that. I have a small little video here, so let me give you an example. This was a demo here done at the SAT, and I'll say more about this in a minute. But basically, let me skip to the part where it actually shows something. This is the screen, okay, so it's too big here. Okay, there. So you see people, you see the screen, that's a huge screen that was set up at the SAT. It was something like 100 feet diameter with 9 projectors together, and the projectors are all over the ceiling. And one important thing there is that you can put the projector anywhere, because you don't care, because the camera will figure out how to distort things so that things look fine from the perspective of the camera. And if it's good for the camera, it's good for you, the viewer, later. Okay. So this is an example. As you can see, the images were huge. The screen was just a curtain. And this is it. With lots of computer in there. But okay. Now let me skip a little bit forward, because that's a long, long example. Okay. But, you know, these were like still images, but also There's an animation. This is immersive. But you will see that right next door later. So, okay. And also, you can do, you know, little animations, things like that. Okay, that's good for that. Okay. Then that's next thing here. That's not. That actually is a dome. That would be the next step. I'll discuss more about this. Now, yeah, this system is not only made for cylinders. It can actually work on any surface as long as one camera can see the surface. So it was tested also on a dome, and it did work fine. Okay. So, but one camera must be able to see everything. Now, the latest screen, which is right here, right next door, is something that looks like this. It's a self-supported structure, about 4.5 meter diameter, 7 projectors. Now, the nice thing here is that it's 7 HD projectors. You have a question?
Yeah. How with cylinder you can see the whole image with one camera?
Ah, well, you need immersive camera.
Can you repeat the question?
Oh, yeah, yeah. The question was, how can one camera see the whole cylinder? Well, you use immersive... Actually, you use the next slide. I have a slide about this, so we'll get to that. Okay, but it's basically a fisheye, for example. Okay, now, if you ask any artist what would be his dream projector, now, if I was to ask everybody here what would be your dream projector, probably it would be something like a projector that can do arbitrary high resolution and project on anything. I mean, that's pretty not too restrictive. And usually I would say, simplicity is most important, but maybe not to people here. Maybe high resolution would be more important than simplicity. But if you want to use this with artists that never touch computers, simplicity is really the key. Otherwise, it doesn't work. Okay, but more important for everybody, low cost. Because if you have many millions of dollars, you can always do anything, almost. Okay? I guess if you want things to be accessible, it should be low cost. That's an idea behind open source too, right? That it's low cost. Now, so what we propose is to use multi-projector, multiple projector camera, software synchronization as well. Okay, now, just one word about distortion. Everybody knows about distortion, but maybe you don't realize what it really means. For example, here in this room, there's only one or two people that can actually see my square image as a true square. It's probably the people right under the projector. Everybody else here actually do not see a square image, but you don't really care. Otherwise, you would be all there. But the reason is you compensate for this because you're happy to see that the image, which is a square, is nicely aligned with the surrounding area, the screen in the room. And so people are not too bothered by that. So, but actually, if the projector, this is the setup, like here. So you're the viewer here, you're on the side, you see this. But it's not too bad because the view is actually aligned with the screen, so you're happy. Now, if it's the reverse, like if the viewer is in front of the screen, but the projector is on the side, like let's say we take the central projector and we move it there, then nobody will enjoy that because it will all be squished like this. And basically people will see a square screen and a distorted image. Nobody will like that. So that's where keystoning comes from, to align the image with the surrounding screen. Okay, well, and then when you apply your keystone, then you can make the image align with whatever you want to make the viewer happy. That's the idea. You don't want to make the projector happy, really. You want to make the viewer happy. That's important. Okay, now, when we go to multiple projectors, we want to make a big image. So we have it's like keystoning, but a little bit more difficult because we need to align things properly. Now, assume here the camera, well, that could be somebody named camera because actually that represents the viewer, okay? Now, this is a perfect setup. Now, if you want to do a large projection like this, it's very hard to achieve a perfect setup because usually there's no space, and it's very hard to put the projector at the right place. So this is more like real life. Well, and also if you have like walls that are curved, maybe that could be fixed. But in general, you will have projectors that are slanted or placed anywhere. And also, could be worse like this, it will be if you project on something curved, then it will be completely messed up. And then there's no way you can adjust this by hand. There's just no way. So you put a camera there, and the camera will represent the virtual projector. Now, before I tell you how we actually match the camera with the projectors to find the alignment, just one word about immersion. That would be quick, though. You all probably know about these kind of things. When you want to immerse people in large screens, instead of using a huge screen, you can use a tiny screen in front of your eyes. The problem with this is it's for a single viewer, and it's kind of expensive too, and it's not a big field of view. And also, whatever you see is not, you don't see the real life, so you can actually trip and fall and hurt yourself pretty bad, actually. But that maybe is not that important. One way also to do immersive displays is to use big screens or big curved screens with a single projector with a wide-angle lens. And in that case, a couple people can see at the same time, but it will tend to be low resolution because you have a single projector. Okay. Now, the other way would be to use multiple projectors, and this is a picture from Lawrence Livermore, a wall of projectors in 1997. It's not that old, but actually 97 with projectors is pretty old. And that actually is very practical because many people can see at the same time. You have a large field of view, and you can use cheap projectors. However, the notion of cheap really changed very fast. So in 97, the projectors there were the resolution is gone. Oh, sorry. Well, anyway, these projectors were 1280 by 1024, 100:1 contrast, which is really low, 1,000 lumen, and 29,000 per projector. Okay, so that was not very affordable. And nowadays, now there have been evolutions in different directions. So it's just like in cars. If anybody knows about the Sony 4K, this is the... why is my resolution gone? Anyway.
Because you've got white income, white background.
I guess that... Yeah, well, I guess that's sad. Anyway, the Sony 4K is a 4,000 pixel wide by 2,000 pixel high image, single image. And however, it looks like a big SUV. It weighs 120 kilos. And it's very expensive, $150,000 per projector. So this is not usable. Now, instead, there's also this other evolution, which is called home theater. And these projectors now are tiny. They're about $2,000-something, 1,200 lumen, and the resolution is HD. So it's 1,900 by 1,080. The contrast is really good, 10,000:1. These are projectors. Oh, by the way, this is real size ratio there on the image. So, and these projectors, the white ones, they're the ones we use here in this setup here. Okay. And the prices of these projectors go down very, very, very fast. So you can expect because these things will be very cheap in a few years. Okay. Now I'm going to skip about the references about doing immersion and things like that. There are many. Okay. So. To get back to Light Twist, so this project started 4 years ago as a collaboration with the Société des Arts Technologiques here in Montreal. And it is intended as an open source software for artists. And well, you have a couple of screenshots. We did use it in many contexts with real artists in public performance, and it did not crash. Well, not too often. So that's pretty important too. You know, in your lab, it's fine when it crash. It's just funny. But in public, it's less funny. Okay, so I'm going to skip this because just go see the screen. But that's basically how it's going to look. It looks better if in space. Now, if you project grids, you can see that each grid is very distorted and there's overlap. Overlap is very important because it allows you to blend things together nicely. So we'll be able to show you that down there. And this is the answer to the question before. So the camera you can use should be fitted with a fisheye or a catadioptric lens, some mirror lens. Whatever is usable to see the whole screen. Okay. Now, okay, so this is what it looks when you project images. I'm going to go skip 3D. There are two kinds of content. I already said that. 3D stuff and 2D stuff. I guess 1D and 4D are not that interesting. So we stick to 3D and 2D. That covers pretty much almost everything that people want to do. Okay, this is what the camera sees, actually. So this is the perspective of the camera. It's not, well, I mean, it's kind of a donut, and you can see six little dots that were the six projectors. And, well, that's a detail. But the artist is not going to want to work on a donut like this. Even if you work in, let's say, GIMP or something, if you have immersive images, it's not always fun to work at that in that mapping. So we propose that we use what we call the artist-friendly coordinate system, which is basically the artist picks his coordinate system, and then we map it at the right to the camera. So this is the favorite one for cylindrical screens. Of course, it's an unwrapped cylinder. And then you need to map this onto the donut. And the way we map things, because everything is 2D, it's very easy to map from the camera image there to the artist image, and also to map from the projector to the camera. And I'm going to explain how we do that. But basically, we do have the mapping between the camera and the projector. Okay? Notice the arrow directions. The camera goes to the projector, and it goes to the artist there. And we're going to have to reverse that arrow there. Because in the end, what we want to do is take the artist image and project it. Right? So we want to go from artist to projector. So we're going to go artist to, we're going to go projector to camera to artist. Anyway, okay, so one thing that's important, as people with, Hugin, for example, the tool where you do panoramas, you need to calibrate the camera at some point. You need to know what was the field of view and other characteristics like distortion, radial distortion, things like that. So this is the same. So since everything is 2D, all you have to specify is the inside and outside of the donut there in green and red. And pretty much that will map to the cylinder there, the unrolled cylinder. And you're pretty much happy. There's a very little calibration required if you want to do basic mapping. Okay, that's very important because sometimes when you ask an artist, what is the, you know, the coefficient for distortion, radial distortion of your camera, they don't know, and they don't care also. So they want to see it on the screen. And of course, then, on the screen, if it's all wrong, then they will go back and maybe look at this. But it's very important to keep things as simple as possible, even if you're going to have some level of distortion, because sometimes distortion is completely acceptable when you project things. Or even more, sometimes it's artistic. Yeah. Who knows? Sometimes I've had people tell me that they prefer distorted image than the non-distorted one. Okay, how do you map from the projector to the camera? Now, everybody probably has known these simple system where, let's say, you project a grid, and then you take a picture, and then you look at the grid, and then the grid is distorted, and so you compute some mapping. Now, this is parameterized mapping. And in our case, what we do is something that is non-parameterized, which means that for every pixel of the camera, we're going to find which projector goes there. Okay, so we project bit patterns, okay, that encodes the coordinates in the projector bit by bit. And it goes like this. Let me just show you. It's not really an amazing video, but whoops. Does it work? Yeah. Well, so this, it looks like this, okay? Anybody who wants to see this live, we can show you down there. It's very fast to calibrate, and you get a complete mapping. So if there's like a bump or something, it will be correctly mapped. Anything will be mapped correctly. Discontinuities, anything. Okay, so, that's not funny. Anyway, well, I guess you get the 50-to-1 there. There's one point to make in this slide, which is that a projector, fill the blanks if you want, a projector which is HD has 2 megapixels per image, right? But the camera that looks at the screen with one image must see seven projector at the time. So this is about 50 projector pixel for one camera pixel, basically. And so that's not funny because the camera wants to know which projector pixel comes to a particular pixel, but there are about 50 of them that goes into one. So that's what we call the pixel ratio problem. And 50 to 1 means about 7 by 7 pixel to 1, a little square of 7 cm. Now, so what's important there is just to know that the camera should be as high-res as you can. But other than that, you're going to need smoothing to make things nice, okay? And if the surface is not smooth, well, then get a better camera if you want really sharp edge. Okay, now back to this. Now, I really hate that my equations are gone, but that's good because anyway, I'm going to skip this slide. I don't want to give you too many. Wow, that's okay. So all the math is going to be really, really summarized, okay? Which is good because anyway, I didn't want anybody wants to discuss detailed equations about how exactly you map or anything mathematical. I guess we can discuss later, okay? These little graphics work. What here is important to know is when things go well, you project an image that will be really white or really black. And when you subtract white and black, that's either very negative or very positive. But in the middle there, if you observe something gray and then something gray and then you subtract, then it's ambiguous. You don't know if it was white or black. And so that area is ambiguous. And so you must create some kind of probabilistic model to try to figure out what happened there when you see gray and you're supposed to see either white or black, okay? But, and you know, you can summarize with probabilities, but it's just a detail, okay? Now, one important thing also, you must invert the mapping. So this is a slight problem because of the pixel ratio problem you have. The mapping is not perfect, I mean, it's not that easy to inverse. So, but, I mean, it's feasible because we've done it, but. Okay, a word about, how do you say, up until now, it was all about geometric alignment, how to align the pixels. But there's another kind of alignment, which is photometric, because projectors don't have the same intensity, okay? So this includes gamma corrections and also all kinds of other things like color, whatever, okay? This is an example. We took a picture with all the lights on of all the projectors and see the difference between all the projectors. It's really amazing. Good enough, I mean, we're happy that our eyes compensate a lot for these kind of things. And so it looks worse for the camera than for us. Okay, it's not funny that all my equations are gone. Okay, well, just a word on, you know, how we project content. So the point here is that many slow machines are much better than one big fast one, okay? And less expensive. And also it breaks less because if you have a one server, it breaks, well, that's it, you're done. If you have one machine dead, then you can just replace one if you have many, okay? So this is what we do here. It's a concept of divide the work. And we tend to use one machine per projector. Mm-hmm. Now we could discuss for a long time how to do 3D on multiple machines. Okay, there are many different ways and approaches to this, but what we've done is pretty much take everything that is static and send it to all the machines separately, and the machines don't exchange 3D information. They only exchange the smallest amount of information, like position information, things like that. But there are many, many different field of philosophy on this. Okay. Well, basically, you're going to see that later, so I'm going to skip this. But we can play video, mix video with 3D. Okay. So that's not a problem. Now, since there are many people here doing graphics, I'll just say one word about how can you play a video that's 8,000 pixels wide on a screen like this with seven different machines. So of course, one way is to just copy the movie on every machine and then play it. But then when you decode the movie, you waste a lot of space because one machine does only one part of the movie. So that's only good for live video, but other than that, and actually 8,000 pixel wide live video, that's pretty hard. Okay, so one thing you could do is pre-render everything. But then if you pre-render everything, it plays very fast, but then if you change the projector position, well, you have to re-pre-render everything. So pre-rendering is not an ideal thing for video. Well, so one thing you could do is basically cut the video in chunks that correspond exactly to the area of the projector here that is used. And so later you decode only the part that you need and you distort it live, which is easy, and that works really well. But again, if you change the projector position, you must redo it again. So finally, the best way is just to tile the video. Okay? That might bring back some I think like GIMP and other programs like tiling a lot to work on big images. It's the same. So you just tile things, and then when it's time to play a video, you just play many small videos at the same time. You just put them together. It works really well. Okay, so that's the summary, but... Okay, now 3D, I won't talk too much about 3D, except that to do accurate 3D, you need accurate camera calibration. That's important. And the thing to remember is that in the LightTwist system, because the camera is there, you don't need to know the 3D position of the projector itself. It could be anywhere, that's not important. So at least you don't have to model projectors. All you need to model is the camera and the screen. Okay? So that's it. So I'm going to skip that also. Again, calibrating for 3D is a matter of knowing the field of view, knowing the height of the screen compared to your eyes, things like that. And also the distortion, the radial distortion of the camera, so you can have all kinds of camera. And that actually is where it ties to, for example, Hugin problem with camera modeling. So if there's a database of camera internal parameters, these could be used directly in that system. Okay, there's no equation there, but as you can see, projectors are linked to camera, camera is linked to 3D representation, and then you're happy. Okay, now a word, actually, how am I doing on time here? 11:12, I guess time is passing, isn't it? Where's the time? Yeah, so I'm going to go real fast to finish this. Software architecture is very simple. We use a lot of open things. OpenCV, OpenSynGraph, FFmpeg, Pure Data for synchronizing sound, and a bunch of other things. But basically, that's the basics. OpenSynGraph, well, it's a high-performance 3D graphics library. Works really well. Pure Data is an open source version of MaxMSP for those who do sound. And actually, it's meant for sound, but actually, it's very good for anything interactive, like controlling video. Okay, and then, well, of course, networking is very important. So we developed our own bidirectional multicasting library to be able to control from one computer the bunch of computers that do the display. It's very important that the video shows up at the same time on every projector. Otherwise, it looks bad. It looked very bad, actually. One word about sound and video. This might sound obvious, but they're kind of different. Video can wait and skip images, and you won't be bothered too much. But sound cannot wait, okay? Because it will just, you know, create gaps. So because of that, whenever there's sound with the projection, audio is the reference. So audio rules everything, and video should try to follow the audio. That's how we did it, and it works really well. Okay, just so it's something to remember. If you try to get the sound to follow the image, you'll have a lot of trouble. Okay, and then what else? How does LightTwist fit with the graphics software community? Well, it might probably appear obvious for now, but We're very close to Huygens because Huygens is interested in very high resolution panoramic images. And the question is, how do you project these things? And you'll be able to see a few of these later. So I think it matched really well there, because if you create images, you also want to see them. And screens are always a little bit too small for that. And finally, well, ties to Blender possibly and other graphics, but the program. But my point here is that it's up to actually you who are in that community to see it and actually tell me if there is any use that that could be linked to various graphics software. So anyway, so that pretty much will conclude. Just to finish, this Lightris project is available as open source now, and it will be developed and in close ties with Huygens in the future. And there are many future challenges, but I'll just mention one which is not a future challenge anymore: stereo immersive projection, which is something we're working hard right now on. And we actually should be able to show you an example of this with red-blue glasses, but we figured a way to do stereo projection, but on 360 degrees, so that many people can see in stereo in different directions at the same time. So I'll be happy to discuss that with whoever is interested, but that's really beside the talk. Mm-hmm. So that pretty much concludes, and since we have a demo, we'll be happy, me and my student also, Vincent, to talk with you and discuss the details if you have any questions. So thank you. And I don't know if we have time for questions, but there's one there, maybe.
Firstly, if you give me the files, if the equations are on there, on the recording, we'll make sure they're on. Okay, so if people want to see it again, you
can. Oh, sure, sure.
One basic thing I don't understand is you say if you've got one camera, so is this all designed for one person? How can you get all the distortions right for more than one person?
One camera, if it's one regular camera, it does represent one point of view of one person, okay? And if you want to try to make like a large wall, projection wall, you can put the camera in the middle, just like that camera there. And the camera can see, and the camera will represent the framework where you align everything. But as in this room here, people do not have to sit where the camera is to enjoy the projection, because it's on a flat screen. Now, if it's on a curved screen, like an immersive screen, then the camera is a fisheye, and nobody is a fisheye, right? So the camera represents a point of view which is 360 degrees. So it will look fine for anyone in the screen in any direction, because it will align the image with the screen. And that's the basic idea. But that's why one camera works. Mm-hmm.
Well, it's not really a question, but I'm just going to mention that I'm going to show some of the DOM work we've been doing in Blender in collaboration with SAT, mm-hmm. doing DOM projection. So I'm going to talk about that in my Friday morning DOM.
Oh, okay, very nice. Yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I noticed at the beginning in one of your pictures you had a big curved screen with pillars in front of it.
Yep.
And I can imagine that the camera would have to have a clear view of the entire screen.
Yep.
So how did you deal with that?
Yeah, making pillars disappear is not easy, but it's very feasible. Now, if you have, first of all, one very important thing, if the screen is inside pillars and the pillars actually are blocking the projectors, then that's really bad. Okay, but because there's no constraint on the position of the projector, you can always place them in a way that will project right near the pillars, so that actually pillars blocking the projector are never that much of a problem. Now, pillars inside, well, then the camera obviously cannot see through the pillar, but the projector can project there. So if you assume that the screen is reasonably continuous, you have to make this assumption that the screen is continuous, then just before and just after the pillar, you can actually fill the hole. And it's not a problem at all. And you just fit a parametric surface which is smooth, and you're done. And we did that at the SAT because there were four pillars there, and it was filled fine. So it's always possible, if things are smooth.
What about real-time content?
Well, we've done real-time content, but not real-time huge videos, because it's just not manageable. But everything video that is a reasonable size can be broadcast using multicasting to every machine and then put directly on the screen at the right place. Of course, only some of the machine will use the video if the video happens to be on their projector, but that's very easy to do. Now, so interactive live video is not hard. Now, as far as 3D, okay, what we've done is static 3D scenes are sent on machines, and whenever we want to change something in the scene, like let's say, for example, you have a city and you have cars. Now, the cars are moving, and that's a bother because you have to really send commands to every machine to tell them, well, move the car. But that's how we do it. So we actually send information about the animation, and we try to store as much static things as possible in the machine, and anything dynamic we send over the network. So it's actually, it works pretty well. You need the microphone.
So since you have replaced the bothersome project alignment with a probably easier problem of aligning the camera inside the screen, so what are your experiences with that? Do you I could think of having reference points on your screen that get detected by your camera, so that this might become easier.
Actually, we did work with markers at some point. There's a big problem with markers. First of all, you don't detect them all the time. It's not necessarily easy. And also, second, if you project things, it gives you, I mean, it doesn't buy you much more than the structured light you have at the start. But we found out it was easier to just click on the camera image. A human click at points that you see is a reference. For example, the speakers for sound are manually aligned with the image, but it's very easy because you look at the picture and you see the speaker in the picture. So you just click on the speaker and say, this is one speaker, this is number two. And then that's how we could put markers on things, but it turns out that it adds a level of complexity. Every time there's a marker, there's a possibility you don't see the marker. So also we've published recently a paper on how to calibrate a projector if you really want to know where your projector is without any markers, using only a camera. So it is possible. You need a wall, though. But a wall is easier to find than a marker, in some sense. So maybe one more, if
one last question.
Time is it.
So I guess this could be applied to a complete 360-degree sphere, right? Not only a dome.
Yeah, we did it. Yeah.
And for the feasibility of things, the least amount of projectors that you would require to have, let's say, a dome-shaped projection,
well,
what would it be? Is there a trade-off between the numbers of projectors?
Yeah, it's a tough question to answer, but the least amount of projector is one. That's for sure. We've did some testing. For example, we put a curved convex mirror, first surface mirror, and we just put one projector, project on it, and then it bounces everywhere, and it makes some kind of a dome without any problem. And LightTwist will be happy with that as long as you stick a fisheye camera inside somewhere to see what's happening, okay? But one projector is fine. You can use two, you can use three, you can use many. As long as the surface of the screen is covered by something, it's fine. You can bounce things on mirrors as much as you want because the camera only cares about the final result on the screen. So it's very, very flexible, but if you use less and less projectors, you have less and less pixels. And also, there are other issues about contrast and things like that, but basically, you have to think about what is the resolution that I need, and then, of course, how many projectors do I have? That's for sure. But the smallest setups, one projector, that's fine. Also, two or three projectors doing just a big home theater, large image with a webcam works also. So it's very flexible. Mm-hmm. So.
Any other questions?
Okay. Okay, well, thanks. And see you maybe at the demo. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.